Hello, my name is Leon Gurris. I'm a food safety expert residing in the Netherlands, and I've worked in the area of food safety research for government and industry. Since 2001, I've been a member of the International Commission on Microbiological Specifications for Foods, or ICMSF, and I represent the Commission at Codex Alimentarius. This presentation is one of several ICMSF video clips on the use of the ICMSF sampling plan tool. These are meant to help users understand the performance of sampling plans specified in microbiological criteria, abbreviated as MCs or as microcriteria. In this one, I will introduce you to the MCs that Codex Alimentarius has proposed for Listeria monocytogenes in ready-to-eat foods. Attend other clips in this series to learn how our ICMSF sampling plan tool can actually be used to assess and interpret the performance of these MCs. As you may know, Codex Alimentarius is the global intergovernmental body that develops food safety standards, codes of practice, and guidelines. When national governments choose to implement elements of these in their regulations as microbiological standards, these are mandatory to comply to for the industry that it concerns. Sometimes there are multiple MCs included in a single standard. In this video clip, as said, I would like to explain to you how the ICMSF sampling plan tool can be used to investigate the performance of such MCs. Understanding the performance of MCs is important for food industry and other stakeholders in the context of the compliance of food products to microbiological standards. The microbiological criteria that I will discuss are the ones that Codex proposed for Listeria monocytogenes in ready-to-eat foods. I will first introduce you to the Codex guidelines in which these MCs are included. Then I will show you details of the MCs proposed for two different groups of ready-to-eat foods. Finally, I will compare the performance of these two MCs to illustrate that they are intended to make the control of Listeria monocytogenes proportional to the potential consumer risk. First then, to the Codex guideline. It's labeled CAC/GL61-2007. The guideline is entitled Guidelines on the Application of General Principles of Food Hygiene to the Control of Listeria monocytogenes in Foods. It has been issued firstly by Codex in 2007. This guidelines document concerns all types of food, but for this presentation we are actually especially interested in those foods for which Codex has established that the use of microcriteria may help governments and food industry to control the occurrence of Listeria monocytogenes and thus to protect consumers. The foods for which Codex believes that MCs are useful are the so-called ready-to-eat foods. These are foods that are literally eaten by consumers as they purchase them. So between purchase and consumption, these foods are not handled or treated in such a way that any risk to consumers is effectively mitigated. For instance, these foods are not subjected to a heat treatment that would kill or inactivate all cells of the pathogen. The Codex code has several annexes. Full details of the rationale for establishing MCs for some food groups can be found in Annex 2 of this guideline. I believe it makes for an interesting read. The two MCs that we will look at a little bit later in this presentation are also included in this Annex 2. But first, a few words on microbiological criteria and how the sampling plan fits into the concept. The use of the concept of microbiological criteria to control microorganisms in a risk-based way has been developed by ICMSF in the 80s. Codex Alimentarius adopted and evolved the concept through several of its standards, codes, and guidelines. For instance, through Codex Code CXG21, issued first in 1997 and updated in 2013, Codex informs governments and industry on the best practice for setting and using MCs. Note that there are many components included in the MC concept according to Codex. It's a long list. It's the food, process or control system to which the MC applies, the point in the food chain where it applies, the microorganism and why it has been selected, the microbiological limits, small m and big m, and a sampling plan defining the number of sample units to be taken, N, the size of the analytical unit, and the acceptance number, C. An indication of the statistical performance of the sampling plan, analytical methods and actions to be taken when the criterion is not met. With all these components specified, it is expected that an MC is absolutely clear to stakeholders. In order to obtain information relevant for establishing useful and proportional MCs for the pathogen and commodity combination we are discussing, Codex Alimentarius commissioned a microbiological risk assessment, or MRA, concerning Listeria monocytogenes in RTE foods. This MRA was compiled by experts working under the umbrella of the Joint Expert Meetings on Microbiological Risk Assessment, JEMRA. The JEMRA group published their investigation and findings in Book 4 and 5 of the series of JEMRA reports. In their risk assessment, the JEMRA group investigated four types of RTE foods in great detail. In pairs, these four types are considered as representative of the range of RTE foods on the market. Pasteurized milk and ice cream both are pasteurized products in which LM levels are typically low. But milk supports the growth of the pathogen and it is consumed a lot. When properly frozen, ice cream doesn't support the growth of LM. Fermented meat and cold smoked fish are infrequently consumed but frequently contaminated with LM. While fermented meat does not support growth of the pathogen, cold smoked fish does. The findings of the JEMRA experts can be summarized in the following three key insights that are relevant for establishing microcriteria. Number one, the vast majority of illnesses due to Listeria monocytogenes, i.e. listeriosis cases, results from the ingestion of very high numbers of cells of the pathogen, in the order of millions per gram. Two, when generally healthy people consume RTE food with low numbers of LM, there is a very low probability of illness. And three, RTE foods differ in two important aspects, the relative presence of LM and the ability of the food product to support growth of the pathogen. The latter key difference was considered by Codex to be a good basis for the control of LM and for the protection of the health of consumers. That is why Codex included two MCs in Annex 2. One MC for foods in which growth of Listeria monocytogenes will not occur, so foods that do not support LM growth, and another MC for foods in which growth of L monocytogenes can occur. Those are the foods that do support LM growth. Here you see an overview of the MC proposed by Codex for RTE foods that do not support LM growth. The top part, the data in the box, is what often is included in microbiological standards. But here you also see all the other details that Codex considers important too. Codex specifies that the food criterion applies to Codex specifies the type of food that the MC applies to, namely the RTE foods that do not support LM growth. The microorganism is clearly identified, L monocytogenes, and it is stated that the MC applies from the end of manufacture or port of entry to the point of sale. The sampling plan and limit for LM are specified, as well as details of the method of for detection and the typical actions to take when a food lot does not meet the MC. To help stakeholders with the interpretation of the stringency of this MC, the performance of the sampling plan is noted as the geometric mean concentration of LM counts given certain assumptions. These assumptions are that pathogen counts in the food lot are log normally distributed, that the analytical standard deviation is 0.25 log CFU per gram, and that the confidence to detect non-compliant lots is 95%. This MC has been established on the basis of some of the key findings from the JEMRA report, which are paraphrased on the top of this slide in terms of rationale. For foods not supporting LM growth, a low level of the pathogen may be tolerable for the generally healthy consumers, while high LM levels that are unsafe for these consumers occur very, very infrequently. Moreover, levels of LM found in RTE foods are very rarely over 1,000 CFU per gram. On the basis of these insights, Codex proposed a two-class sampling plan for LM in which the limit small m is 100 CFU per gram. The number of sample units to test n is 5, and none of these, C is 0, should be over the limit of m. A food lot would not be compliant when one or more of the 5 sample units would be over 100 CFU per gram. Assuming a log normal distribution of counts, a standard deviation of counts of 0.25 log CFU per gram and 95% confidence to detect a non-compliant lot, the interpretation of this MC for the status of the food lot that just meets the sampling plan is specified here. For such a food lot, it would be expected that LM levels in 55% of samples taken would be below 100 CFU per gram. But note that 100 CFU per gram is not an upper limit for LM, because 45% of samples would be expected to be over 100 CFU per gram. However, of the samples over 100 CFU per gram, only a small fraction, 0.002, would be expected to be over 1,000 CFU per gram. Here you see the MC that has been proposed by Codex for RTE food in which LM can grow, so foods that do support LM growth. Again, all necessary details are specified to make the MC clear to stakeholders: the pathogen, the food type and point of application, the sampling plan and limits for LM, details of the method for detection, and the typical actions to take when a food lot doesn't meet the MC. Also in this case, the performance of the sampling plan is specified, given the same assumptions as we saw for the other MC. Concerning the rationale for this MC, a basic insight is that there is no control of the growth of LM when it is present in the food, and that therefore an MC should help ensure that LM levels in a food lot are so low that there is a rather large safety margin to those levels that are considered unsafe. Codex considers that an MC with a two-class sampling plan, n is 5, c is 0, and m is absence in 25 gram, meets that requirement. Note that absence of LM in 25 gram in combination with the method of LM detection advised by Codex, which is the ISO 16140, means that the LM concentration in a sample unit would be less than 0.04 CFU per gram. Given these assumptions, a food lot that would only just meet the sampling plan is as specified here. It is expected that 55% would be negative for LM, while 45% would be positive. Of the positive samples, 0.5% could be above 0.1 CFU per gram, but even much smaller fractions would be above 1 or 10 CFU per gram. In this slide, I place the MCs for the two groups of RTE food products side by side to compare their stringency of control over LM. The left plot indicates the distribution of LM counts in a lot of food supporting growth of LM, and the right plot is for a lot of food that does not support LM growth. As you can see, the geometric mean for the food lot supporting growth is between 3 and 4 logs lower, in part providing for what was thought by Codex to be a necessary safety margin. So while both MCs should not be considered as lines in the sand, they do provide for a risk-based and proportional stringency of control on the occurrence of LM in RTE foods. In summary, Codex Alimentarius typically uses risk assessments to inform its risk management decision-making. The micro-criteria that Codex established in this way for the control of Listeria monocytogenes in ready-to-eat foods are risk-based. On the basis of the micro-risk assessment carried out by GEMRA, Codex has proposed separate MCs for foods that do and for foods that do not support growth. The stringencies of these separate MCs regarding LM control are proportional to the consumer risk potentially associated to these two different groups of RTE foods. Please see our other clips concerning this codex guideline and how the ISMZF sampling plan tool can actually be used to assess and interpret the performance of the two MCs. For more information on ISMZF, you're welcome to visit our website, ismzf.org. I thank you for your attention.